go to you for your receivers that you're targeting.
Let's see who I wrote down here. I like Alan Lazard in the eighth. I think at the moment, there's not a lot going on in Green Bay. I think
we've talked about Lazard.
Yeah, I mean, in the eighth round, he's usually there, and there's not a lot of competition right now for targets, and at least he's a body that, you know, Aaron Rodgers is familiar with. So I think that, you know, they have the chemistry. I think he's someone I like. Another guy I like that a lot of people do not is Robert Woods in the ninth. I feel like people are just kind of writing him off because he got hurt last year. But I mean, in that Tennessee offense, there's just not a lot going on there. I mean, yeah. AJ Brown is gone. Like, I feel like Woods, I mean, yes, they are run heavy. Yes, that offense goes to Derrick Henry. But I think Tannehill and Woods, if they can get, you know, if they can gel, I feel like he's a guy that people are kind of blowing off. And, you know, I mean, I'm not going to take him in every league or anything, but I feel like he's someone right now with a ninth round ADP that, you know, if you decide to go running back heavy and you need to scoop some of those guys up in those middle rounds, I think he's there. I do have one more guy that I like that I kind of added at the last minute that has been growing on me is Jarvis Landry. I know people aren't super thrilled about Jameis Winston, nor am I, but I feel like once again, in that offense, I mean, everywhere Jarvis has been, he's been a target hog. So why not show up in New Orleans? If Michael Thomas isn't, you know, full health or isn't good to go, you've got a rookie in Olave, like Jarvis Landry's there. And I feel like they could, you know, he could possibly be a sneaky guy that could get a lot of volume, especially, you know, in any kind of PPR format. And he's right now going in the 11th.
Especially if we see a suspension or something from Alvin Kamara or anything along those lines. Right. Like, man, you could just eat
He's going kind of, people are just kind of writing him off or forgetting about him. But it's like, wait a minute. Like, he's, you know, he's there and there's not a lot there, for, you know, in that offense.
I keep drafting Robert Woods just because I'm used to drafting Robert Woods. I've always drafted Robert Woods. This is what I do. Chris, who are your receivers?
The one guy that I'm trying to get as much as I possibly can in the middle rounds is Kadarius Toney. And I think right now there's so much, there has been, at least not right now, I think it's been kind of quiet on him, but like there's so much drama surrounding him. Like, remember last year with the whole like cleats debacle and just all these extra
things. There was a lot of noise.
Yeah, there was just so much noise. And even coming into this offseason, there were like rumors about him getting traded, just always negative news surrounding him. But when he's been on the field, my goodness, it was week 4, the first game that he started like for the Giants after like injuries or whatever that kind of hampered his early part of the season, starts in week 4 against the Saints, who have been known to have a strong defensive secondary, led the team in targets. That's with Kenny Golladay also on the field with him. Saquon Barkley was still there. I mean, this was still an offense that had key pieces as a part of it. Kadarius Toney gets on the field as a rookie and leads the team in targets with 9 targets. I mean, that's already kind of an eyebrow raising moment, like for me, like right there. The fact that this rookie can come in, command that level of targets or that level of target share right out of the gate. But then we've seen so many highlights, like the shiftiness, the acceleration, the burst, like once he gets on the field and like once he gets the ball in his hands. He was what, like top 12 in yards per route run efficiency stat, like from Pro Football Focus, like against man coverage just last year. And that was with just, I think, 54 targets like total. Now in the top 40, I believe, in yards per route run against zone coverage. But the man coverage part is that's really impressive. Like for a rookie of his size and his stature, I mean, built essentially kind of like Tyreek Hill. I mean, has that same like jitterbug type of movement once you get the ball in his hands. But to see that level of efficiency from a rookie against good corners, against good defensive corners, like right out of the gate, and for where he's going for right now, around 100th overall, in a part of a scheme that most of us are excited about now, with so much of the Bills offense like being integrated into the Giants franchise as of right now. So if it's not Kenny Golladay, I mean, I'm trying to get as much Kadarius Toney as I possibly can.
I mean, tons of upside there, like without a doubt. And you talk about Brian Daboll coming over. This offense can't be as bad as it was last year. Like, it almost statistically can't.
It's not possible after the quarterback play that we were subjected to, like towards the back end of the season. Like, it's just not possible.
Oh, it was awful. It's why I'm targeting Kenny Golladay, and I like Kadarius Toney as well. I'm targeting some Toney as well. Kenny Golladay, 10th, 11th round, like early 11th, late 10th round is where you get Kenny Golladay. Stylistically, he's still the only like prototype X receiver on that roster. Like, I mean, Darius Slayton, if you squint really, really close every once in a while, you can see it in him. But generally speaking, Golladay has the size and the deep threat ability. I was looking at Golladay, like, since he entered the league, even with two down seasons the last 2 years, he's still, like, eighth in the league in yards per reception among players with at least 100 targets since 2017. So the guy is a downfield threat. It's just something that he does really well. He wins deep. Better offensive line should give a little more time for the Giants, and that should allow Golladay to get downfield. So, you know, I'm not sold that Golladay is going to rebound after two injury-marred seasons, but 10th, 11th round, I mean, he's the only guy in that range that looks like he could be a wide receiver one right in that spot. Mm-hmm. So I like him, and I like Tyler Lockett, kind of like for Robert Woods' reason. I just keep drafting him. I've always drafted him, and now he's there in the eighth round, so I'll buy the dip. Yes, I'm worried about Geno Smith. Yes, I'm worried about Drew Lock. But in best ball, Tyler Lockett, he's still going to have three games where he gets multiple touchdowns. Like, it's just what he does, and so I'm going to do that. The only dilemma I have for him is whether I take him or Christian Kirk in the eighth round. That's it.
That's fair. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you, there's somebody I don't like in these rounds because I thought he was going way lower than this. Elijah Moore is a sixth round pick. He's going ahead of Devontae Smith, Adam Thielen, Hunter Renfrow. He's going ahead of these guys. What do you guys think of this?
I agree with that. It's difficult for me to see him outkicking his ADP, and that's not from a talent standpoint.
Oh, sure, love the kid.
I still think that maybe from a dynasty standpoint, you can make the case for maybe trying to acquire him in a trade or whatever. But for this year, just think of all the things that have to go right for Elijah Moore to be, let's say, a high-end fantasy target. Like, one, he has to earn targets in an offense that is going to have, I mean, piloted by Zach Wilson, but also added Jameson Williams. Garrett Wilson, sorry.
He's buff.
Yeah, and then also the two tight ends as well. I mean, they've added more pass catchers in the lineup. I mean, Breece Hall is also supposed to command targets as well. So target competition is there for him. And then also Zach Wilson being under center, we're expecting him to make, like, his leap, like, from his, like, awful rookie season. So, I mean, you're expecting, like, both of those things to hit for Elijah Moore, and that's not really priced in at this point, in my eyes. Like we were just talking, I mean, if we've got Kadarius Toney and then also Kenny Golladay, who really the only thing that has to go right is for Daniel Jones to stay upright, that's one less thing.
Yeah.
That Elijah Moore has to worry about.
Yeah.
So it's just the case for either the Giants receivers to me is much stronger than Elijah Moore right now, to be quite honest.
I'm with you. Sixth round. And I'm with you. I like Elijah Moore. But you're right. Yeah. Everything has to go right for him to be worth that pick. It's not even like you're drafting just to the ceiling.
It. Yeah. It's not even to exceed it. It's just for him to meet his cost.
That's the way I feel.